And welcome to Metropolis Healthcare Limited Q4 and FY 2020 earnings conference call. This conference call may contain forward-looking statements about the company, which are based on the beliefs, opinions, and expectations of the company as on date of this call. These statements are not the guarantees of future performance and involve risks and uncertainties that are difficult to predict. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Ameera Shah, MD, Metropolis Healthcare Limited. Thank you, and over to you, Mr. Shah.
Thank you, and good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us for the Q4 FY 2020 earnings call. I'm today joined by Vijender Singh, CEO, and Rakesh Agarwal, CFO, and SGA IR advisors. The presentation and press release has been issued to the stock exchanges and uploaded on our company website. I hope everyone has had a chance to have a look at our performance. Let me begin by stating that we remain supremely confident on the growth of our business and industry and believe we are at the cusp of a dynamic shift towards organized diagnostics in India, where players like Metropolis will gain and cement leadership position. While we may have short-term pain in immediate months to follow, the normalization of operations will increase momentum in favor of organized players. The last time we spoke, no one would have imagined the extent of spread of coronavirus in India. In early March, we were continuously asked by everyone if we'd be testing for COVID-19. With specialized experience of over 26 years in molecular biology techniques, we were always fully prepared to meet the testing needs and challenges. At Metropolis, resilience is inbuilt in our DNA, and the entire Metropolis family is working together with a deep sense of urgency, passion, and commitment. The only goal for our experienced team of doctors and scientific team is to be able to help patients and doctors to get a reliable diagnosis as quickly as possible. Let me now give you a quick update on COVID-19 impact on our business, our resilient model, which has emerged stronger during the crisis, how we believe the industry will shape the post-COVID era, and I will spend some time on Q1 FY 2021 outlook and overall FY 2021 objectives. Q4 is traditionally the strongest quarter for our company in the diagnostics industry. With absence of festivals, vacations, Q4 tends to be a very strong revenue quarter for us. Q4 FY 2020 began on a very positive note with strong momentum in January and February, where we saw 13.5% growth in January and 17.5% growth in February, and our March revenues were very strong. Had we not been in lockdown situation, we would have witnessed our best monthly and quarterly revenue. On account of COVID-19, we believe we have lost 25 crores in revenue and approximately 17 crores in EBITDA. The reason I say 17 crores, which appears a bit high, is for two reasons. One, we get price benefits that typically flow in on account of high volumes we were clocking for March month, as well as for January, February, March at the end of the quarter, which did not come in this time because we were not able to reach the numbers for volume. Second, subsequent operating leverage benefits. Let me now spend some time on how we view COVID-19 and subsequent business environment. COVID-19, I'm happy to share that we were the first private lab in the country to start testing for this test. With the best TAT, which is turnaround time of reports, continuous medical engagement with doctors and government authorities, strong branding, and customer equity that we enjoy, we were successful in churning out COVID-19 testing. Initially, the testing lab was set up in our global reference lab in Mumbai. However, as volume increased, we set it up at a separate facility, at a dedicated facility in Thane, which is in Bombay, and subsequently in Chennai, Bangalore, Pune, and Delhi. We have strengthened the safety and collection protocols across our lab network with heightened training for our collection and testing staff. We are ensuring minimum disruption due to availability of manpower. Each location during crisis had a business continuity plan coordinator to raise red flags in terms of absenteeism and sickness. Crisis management team of clinicians and lab head were identified who will be backup for processing units. We had 100% adherence to Ministry of Health and Family Welfare guidelines. Over the course of April and May, we have processed samples from across India. Our CapEx investment in setting up COVID-19 tests is estimated about 1.25 crores. With testing price capped at 4,500 per test, the realization is not profit accretive for unit economic basis on per test, but will help us in covering fixed costs in a significant way and therefore minimizing margin downfall. We are happy to report that COVID-19 has given huge impetus to our stakeholder engagement, whether it be doctors, central and state governments, regulators, in not only existing markets but new markets as well. It has certainly improved the brand equity for Metropolis at all levels. In our view, the way forward for COVID-19 is expected to be as follows. safety and hygiene will become very important to the consumer. So we will use this as an opportunity to use our professional services to gain market share. As we know, the unorganized sector does not tend to have safety and hygiene parameters to the same extent. More point of care testing will emerge for testing at home, and we are evaluating how we can participate in this opportunity. Corporate individuals will want to do antibody testing in large scale to scan the immunity levels of workforce. If the government permits, this will be an opportunity. And people may want more home visits rather than walk into centers. We are scaling this up in a significant manner and expect it to be a big opportunity for organized and trusted brands to gain more market share. It will also allow rationalization of front-end network and cost savings. At a macro level, we strongly believe COVID-19 will change the operating dynamics for the industry, and organized and capable testing laboratories such as ours will be the biggest beneficiary of this change. We estimate that unorganized standalone labs are facing severe cost pressures due to lockdown. With faster adoption of quality standards, partly enforced by government and partly indirectly forced upon by customers, there could be closure of operations for many of these standalone labs. Another important factor we foresee for the industry will be that the customer will no longer view pricing as a criteria for lab selection, but quality as the number one criteria. Higher quality standards, authentic reports, after-sales service, and doctor engagement will be key factors enabling lab selection process. And this is where organized labs will outscore. Indian customers will view diagnostic chains as COVID-19 capable and non-COVID-19 capable. As these tests will become the new norm, more market share will shift towards the more capable labs as we have seen post-SARS. Diagnostic chains which have a lean balance sheet, strong consumer connect, and high quality standards will therefore gain market share. Finally, we expect faster consolidation in the industry along with changes in the regulatory framework. Let me now give you some insight on how we at Metropolis have built a resilient model which has stood the test of COVID-19 and continues to gain momentum with each passing day. Our first initiative in lockdown was reduction of our fixed and semi-variable costs. We initiated this exercise in March 20 and are happy to report we were successful in reducing our fixed and semi-variable costs by 20 to 22%. Further, we have increased spend on smarter digital initiatives and doctor engagement, connect to customers, and medical knowledge sharing to improve our brand equity. Our second initiative was to be COVID-19 ready in more cities. Having spread to more cities and with COVID-19 antibody testing ready, we have increased our brand equity in markets of our operations and strengthened our leadership position. Our third initiative was network rationalization. In April 2020, we have initiated steps to rationalize our collection center network and anticipated this exercise to continue till June and July 2020. The rationalization exercise will see a 10 to 15% reduction ARC network, which was not contributing meaningfully to revenue and were at the bottom of the pyramid, but they're adding a little bit of cost to maintain them. So by rationalizing the network, it will help us reduce some of these costs. All of this has resulted in resilient performance, the results of which are as follows. The last 15 days of March 2020, we witnessed sharp revenue degrowth of 46% on YOY basis, where it clocked revenues of 21 crores against our expectation of 46 crores. In April 2020, we achieved 40% of the revenue we clocked in April 19. With improving logistics, improving engagement with doctors, and COVID-19 testing scaling up, we have been able to achieve 65% of May 2019 revenues in May 2020 as of date. And we expect improvement to continue in June 20 as well, as we continue to drive specialized tests, COVID-19 testing, and doctor clinic opening up for getting access to routine samples. With a strong balance sheet, asset-light model, and high cash reserves of 223 crores, Metropolis is well placed to weather the storm and poised to increase market share. Having said this, it is important for us to highlight the Q1 FY21 outlook here. Revenue in April 2020 was down to 40% of the normal trend and is expected to improve to about 75% to potentially higher of the June 2020 compared to last June 2019. April 2020 saw EBITDA loss followed by break even in May 2020, which is expected to turn to EBITDA positive in June 2020. In the beginning of the lockdown, we had around 75% of our lab network non-functional. And slowly and gradually, we are opening up all our laboratories. 15 to 20% of the owned collection centers were operating at the end of March, and we have now commenced operations in 50% of our network. One of the important pillars of our business is human resources. Let me give you a quick snapshot of our efforts here. We have ensured continuous engagement and communication with all our employees while ensuring timely payment of salaries, ensuring no job losses and continuity of workforce. We are evaluating a flexi system of work from home for our employees, which will have dual benefits in terms of employee productivity as well as cost reduction. Safety and hygiene of employees is very important. So we are engaging in continuous training programs to upskill our workforce. Continuously working on strengthening our scientific brand with focus on quality of talent in our processing unit. I'll now spell out our focus areas for FY21, which will be as follows. Increase productivity of our young network and rationalize the network when needed in order to not only save costs, but improving efficiency and revenue per center. Improving our collection efficiency, especially in our B2B network, resulting in improvement in DSO days, which is the outstanding receivables days. Prudently evaluating inorganic opportunities and strengthening our market position in existing markets and new geographies. Continue to do cost rationalization exercise to benefit from operating leverage, which will play out as we scale up revenue. I'm also happy to share that we've recently partnered with Cipla Foundation and Citibank Foundation under the aegis of NGO United Way. Under this initiative of Cipla, Citibank, and Metropolis, we will be testing up to 100,000 unaffording patients for COVID-19. This will not only utilize the expertise of Metropolis, but will also help us build a stronger consumer and government interface and thus build volume for COVID testing, thereby keeping our labs productive and helping us move faster towards improved group profitability. While Cipla and Citibank Foundation will be funding these tests, Metropolis will be using all our skills to be able to do this in partnership. Metropolis has always put people first, and we will continue to strongly hold on to this value that will help us navigate this unprecedented crisis. As an organization, we remain empathetic to all our stakeholders, as quality and safety and hygiene will remain our top priority going forward. There is no doubt in our minds that we will not only emerge stronger from this crisis, but with more empathy, compassion, and determination. That's all from my side. I would now like to hand over to Vijinder, our CEO, to take you through some of the operational plans.
Yeah, thank you, Ameera, and good evening, everyone. Let me give you a perspective on our operational parameters. We had a strong FY20 in terms of all operational and financial parameters, barring the last 16 days of March quarter, where we lost business on account of COVID-19 outbreaks across the country. For FY20, we reported patient visits of 10 million, which is a milestone in itself, witnessing a growth of 11.3% on year-on-year basis. The growth would have been higher had it not been for Q4 FY20, where we saw a degrowth of 3.3%. For FY20, our patient test grew faster at 19.62 million, a growth of 15.7%. Q4 FY20 saw a muted growth of 7.1%. On year-on-year basis, number of tests saw a growth of 13% in January, a healthy 28% in February, and a degrowth of 16% in March, impacted by lockdown. Our revenue per patient continues to remain stable at ₹856 per patient for FY20 versus ₹854 in FY19. For Q4 FY20, we reported an increase of 6% on year-on-year basis from ₹794 per patient in Q4 FY19 to ₹841 per patient in Q4 FY20. Revenue per test grew by 2% from ₹447 per test in FY19 to ₹436 per test in FY20. The larger drop was witnessed in Q4 FY20, where the revenue per test dropped by 4% from ₹409 in Q4 FY19 to ₹392 in Q4 FY20. Our revenue profile among focus cities and other cities stood as follows. Focus cities, 5 cities including the city and peripheral area around metropolitan region, contribution has moved from 60% in FY19 to 56% in FY20 on back of increased contribution from seeding and other cities. Seeding cities, which is about 8 cities, has moved from 20% in FY19 to 19% in FY20. Other cities' contribution has moved from 20% in FY19 to 25% in FY20, thus growing at a faster pace. Our revenue profile on the basis of geography stood at as follows. West India shares stood at 54% versus 55%. South India shares stood at 26% versus 27%. North India shares stood at 9% versus 8%. East India shares stood at 6% versus 5%. International shares stood at constant 5%. We are happy to report on the progress we are seeing in newer markets of North and East India, which has increased their contribution to the overall business. Moving on to revenue mix, we are pleased to share that we continuously growing on the B2C part of our business. Our B2C revenues in focus cities in FY20 was up by 15.5% on year-on-year basis from Rs. 233 crore in FY19 to Rs. 269 crores in FY20. In focus cities, B2C revenue share stood at 56% in FY20 as compared to 52% in FY19. We reiterate that our strategy is to improve this contribution to 65% in coming years on the back of sharp focus on improving the productivity of our young network. The B2C revenue uptick has been growing steadily on account of greater focus on increasing productivity of our young network to go closer to the patients, obsessively monitoring customer experience and generating a healthy net promoter score across the group. The price increase in B2C business, which we initiated in October 2019, has also started to contribute. Let me now give you highlights of test mix on volume and value basis. FY20 routine tests contributed 39% in terms of volume and 18% in terms of value. Semi-specialized tests contributed 38% in terms of volume and 37% in terms of value. Specialized tests contributed 15% in terms of volume and 37% in terms of value. Wellness contributed 8% in terms of volume and value. We believe that specialized contribution could have grown slightly higher but was affected by the COVID-19 threat in the early March and later the lockdown. Network highlights. Our network expansion and utilization strategy continues to gain traction. From expansion of network, we have now moved on consolidation and focusing more on productivity and profitability of each lab. As a result, we have initiated our service network rationalization exercise in April 2020, and we believe that we should be able to complete this exercise by June, July 2020. We estimate a closure of 10 to 15% centers with no major revenue loss on account of these centers as they are at the bottom of the pyramid, as mentioned previously by Amira. Our patient service network stands at 2731 at end of March 2020 compared to 2781 at end of Q3 and 2336 at the end of FY19. Third-party PSCs comprised of 1873 centers, ARC comprised of 598 centers, while company-owned PSCs comprised of 260 centers. Overall, at the end of FY20, our network counts stood at 124 as compared to 119 at the end of FY19. Our focus will be to increase the throughput at our labs, which will not only give us revenue uptick, but better utilization levels, which are currently estimated at 55 to 60%. This will lead to operating leverage and margin increase and better return ratios as the CapEx cycle for lab network is behind us. 92% of center network and 16% of lab network in assets light in nature. A total of 49 new tests have been validated and added to the test run in Q4 FY20, thus expanding our capability to conduct more specialized tests. These tests are in field of infection, infectious molecular field, chemistry field, and rest in molecular pathology. We strongly believe pathology test run is our biggest forte, and we will continue to spend on R&D and clinical talent to increase our test run. The very fact that we were among the approved private labs by ICMR to start COVID-19 tests and moreover, the first lab to start and deliver tests with the best that speaks volumes of our capabilities in testing and efficiency of our labs. We continue to strengthen our business with a number of technological initiatives wherein we have completed registration and invoicing systems. Further, we have initiated inventory management system, payment platform system and financial module Oracle NetSuite. We expect these initiatives to go live by mid of Q2 FY21 and operational benefits to kick in accordingly. I'm also happy to share that we are working aggressively on cost management, and amongst the few points that Amira highlighted, a key focus area for us has been material cost. We have rolled out our new agreement with the Ross Diagnostics for improvement in routine test pricing and standardization across units. This will help us on material cost once business returns to normal. One of the key changes we foresee post-COVID is that home testing is expected to increase. For safety reasons, we believe more and more customers will adopt for home testing, and to address this, we are beefing up our front-end resources and network partners. To further address this issue, we have appointed Mr. Kannan A. as the Chief Service Officer. He joins us from High Care Services and is a veteran in customer experience in B2B and B2C segments. In his previous stint, he was responsible in implementing the digital field service model to deliver on time service and improve net promoter scores. Our objective for FY21 would continue to be towards increasing utilization of lab networks, increasing revenue per center, rationalize service network, and increase the focus of the sales team towards non-COVID business. We believe we are poised for greater heights in coming quarters as the economics for standalone labs and unorganized labs get beaten down. That's all from my side. I will ask Rakesh, our CFO, to take you through the financials.
Yeah, thank you, Vijender. Good evening to everyone on the call. Financial year 20, given the year-end challenges, we are happy to report that we have made significant efforts towards improving the quality of operation, wherein we are focusing on network rationalization, which will lead to improvement in break-even levels, improving the health of our balance sheet, where we have continued to remain asset-light, increased our cash levels, and continued to grow inorganically through acquisition without compromising on key parameters, increasing the focus on working capital, which has led to improvement of our OFC to EBITDA, which has improved to 93% in financial year 20, an improvement from September 2019 level. And if I compare it with March 19, it has improved more than 100%, ultimately leading to healthy growth of 14.1% for PAT before exceptional item. We have indicated the impact of COVID-19 in our presentation and speech earlier, but I would like to spend some more time in giving an assessment of the growth that we would have achieved. While we have reported revenue of ₹206 crore, we believe we lost 25 crore in revenue for the last 16 days of March, which was impact due to the nationwide lockdown and precautionary measures taken. Accordingly, Q4 financial year 20 revenue would have been ₹231 crore with a growth of 15.1% on year-on-year basis if we had a clear March 2020. To give you a better perspective on the strength of our performance in Q4 financial year 20, I am glad to share that Y-on-Y basis in January we achieved 13.5% growth, February saw growth of 17.4%. For the period of 1st January to 15th March, we achieved 14.5% year-on-year growth, clearly depicting the growth momentum we built up. Similarly, for financial year 20, we reported revenue of ₹856 crore after addition of our estimated ₹25 crore revenue, which we have lost in last 16 days of March 2020, we would have achieved revenue of ₹881 crore, thus clocking a growth of 15.9% on Y-on-Y basis. We believe that the EBITDA margin and profitability would have been increased at higher pace as we would have benefited out of the operating leverage and lower material cost on the basis of revenue and volume numbers we were clocking for Q4 financial year 20. Accordingly, our estimate is that we have lost to be 17 crore in EBITDA for Q4 and financial year 20. Accordingly, our Q4 financial year 20 EBITDA would have been rupees 69 crore, a growth of 19.5% on year-on-year basis with a margin of 29.5%, which is typical of the last quarter in our industry. Similarly, for financial year 20, our EBITDA would have been rupees 249 crore, a growth of 21.1% on Y-on-Y basis with a margin of 28.3%. On our operating metrics have showed vast improvement and continued to post positive trajectory. On reported basis, EBITDA for financial year 20 stood at rupees 232 crore, registering a growth of 12.9% on Y-on-Y basis. Accordingly, the margin stood at 27.11% for financial year 20. In quarter 4 financial year 20, reported EBITDA stood at rupees 52 crore, registering a degrowth of 10.1% with a margin of 25.03%. The EBITDA margin would have been higher by 0.5% if we exclude the lab on lease for financial year 20. The lab on lease contract existing in financial year 19, which were 9 in numbers and fully operational in financial year 19, have moved from 19.5% EBITDA to 22.1% EBITDA margin in financial year 20. The new lease on lab on lease contract started in financial year 20, which is 4 in numbers and partially operational in financial year 17 numbers has diluted the total lab on lease EBITDA to 0.5%, which was as expected. Financial year 20 PBT before exceptional item stood at ₹193.8 crore, a growth of 1.2% on Y-on-Y basis. There was a provision of 17.7 crore pertaining to receivables related to a B2B hospital. While we were under arbitration for recovery of our dues and expected the proceedings to conclude in March 2020, however, COVID-19 has resulted in all judicial matters getting postponed. We now expect the proceeding to conclude by end of the calendar year or early next year. We believe and are confident of recovery of dues from the hospital. However, as a matter of prudency, especially with hospital business getting slowed down on account of COVID-19, we are taking this provision. If and when the case gets over and we win public settle, we will write back the provision. PAT before exceptional items stands at ₹29.3 crore for quarter 4 financial year 20, while the financial year 20 it stands at ₹146.7 crore, an increase of 14.1% on Y-on-Y basis. Reported PAT, that is after provision, stands at ₹15.5 crore for Q4 financial year 20, while for full financial year 20, it increased by 3.2% to ₹127.6 crore. As at 31st March 2020, we had cash and cash equivalent to the tune of ₹223 crore. This shows financial flexibility we have to further strengthen the business operation and cement our leadership position. We are a zero debt company. Our ROCE has improved and stood at 40% in financial year 20, while ROE stood at 27%. Despite the overall COVID-19 impact in March 2020, we have been able to improve our collection efficiencies and improve our DSO days. Our DSO days in financial year 20 before Q4 hospital account provision stood at 62 days, an improvement of 4 days on Y-on-Y basis and 5 days from September 2019 level. Our working capital days improved vastly in financial year 20 on increased efforts towards improving collection efficiency, better inventory management, and better trade of terms with suppliers. Our working capital days, excluding cash and cash equivalent and excluding lease liability on account of Ind AS 116, for comparable purpose and pre-provision of debtors stood at 20 days at the end of March 20, compared to 24 days at the end of September 2019 and 33 days at the end of March 2019. Our CAPEX spend expenditure acquisition stood at ₹22.7 crore. We spent rupees 11 crore towards acquisition, primarily towards the Surat acquisition announced in September-October last year. During the year, we paid dividend, including dividend tax of rupees 48 crore, and thus the dividend payout for financial year 20 stood at 37.5%. This is from my side. We now leave the floor open for Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and 1 on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and 2. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. Before we start with the question answer session, I would like to remind participants, please limit your question to 2 per participant. You may come back in the question queue if you have a follow-up. We take the first question from the line of Rajesh Kothari from AlphaCurate Advisors. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir. First of all, congratulations for a good set of numbers in otherwise a challenging environment. I will make 2-3 questions. The first question, can you give more color on what is your B2B strategy? And in your presentation, you share a lot of data. Revenue per patient, revenue per clinic, so on and so forth. Is it possible to get similar numbers on B2B side, transparency? What is your per hospital maximum exposure? How do you try to reduce the risk so that such incidents of write-offs do not happen in future? That is question number one. Question number two is, in terms of cash flow, while we have seen good improvement, how do you see going forward in terms of your target cash flow? And last question is to the promoters, because there is a pledge of shares, and I'm sure everybody is aware that in such market conditions there are many accidents which have happened in the market. So what are the promoters' thought process by when they plan to reduce this pledge? and you know some color on that. Thank you.
So, Vijendra, why don't you take question one? Rakesh, you can take question two, and I'll come to question three.
Let's be on the B2B side, particular instance, what you are talking is about one hospital lab management where you were running the lab based on management, and there was arbitration, and that arbitration was in our favor. So that was one instance. But if you generally talk about B2B, if you look at, I can little bit talk the forward-looking numbers because COVID is still on. Our B2C ratio actually, what we have seen is in last 2 months has gone up from 44%. As I said in my talk also that B2C ratio currently is about 44% at the group level. However, in last 2 months, this B2C ratio has gone up to almost about 49 to 50%. So our dependence on B2B automatically has reduced. One is of course that B2B during this COVID, as we've seen a lot of B2B, you know, labs and hospitals workshops. And now so a lot of hospitals have also converted to COVID as well. So our dependence on B2B is not very high. However, if you look at our past model, in the past model, we had two different models. One was lab on lease and second was EAPAC model, where we had gone to, you know, small time labs and big time labs who were, you know, B2B customers. So we have asked them to start their lab and converted those into franchises of Metropolis. And in last 2 months also, we have taken a step towards this in order to revive this model, and we were pretty much successful. And we were, let me tell you that we have almost converted about 40 such labs who are now, you know, completely outsourcing 100% to Metropolis. So that is going to be our strategy going forward.
Yeah. So coming to the cash flow question, just to answer you, right now we have a cash flow of 223 crore in our kitty, and you know, happy to say that we have already, you know, started not losing any cash anymore from the business. The operation is started, you know, giving a positive cash flow, so we don't see any challenge going forward. So as of now, we are sitting pretty at 223 crore, and we don't see any challenge to, you know, face from a cash flow and cash burn point of view.
On the promoter pledge, as we know that the pledge is significantly lower than it was even at the time of us listing. I was only waiting for, I had always maintained to sort of all investors and stakeholders that over, you know, the next 12-month period, my interest has always been to exit whatever debt and completely become unpledged. And I continue to stand on the same thought. So anyway, the risk is obviously much lower now than it was earlier. I will continue to evaluate my options and try to unpledge as soon as you know, possible, like I said, over the next 12 months.
Okay. In fact, you know, just to respond to the answer one, which, you know, the management has given, my question is actually completely different. So I'm not asking the B2C if it is going up or not, because it is possible that hospital revenue itself is coming down, and that deserves into the higher proportion of B2C. Now, my question is, what is your risk management policy for B2B? And do you have a minimum benchmark that if your receivable days in a particular, for example, hospital, if it goes up beyond 25 or 35 or 45, you would not probably continue with that? So what is your risk management strategy on B2B? Because it is still a substantial part of your revenue. It is not 5% of your revenue. We are talking about a 40, 45, 50% of revenue. So, you know, some color on your B2B business strategy and risk management, that would be very useful. And to the promoters, madam, you know, as a shareholder, we are concerned, because while I clearly appreciate your target of depledging over the next 12 months, but 12 months in such volatile time is actually very long period. So my sincere request is, if you can address this concern at the earliest, that would put, you know, shareholders like us a little bit on rest. Yeah.
Yeah. So just to answer your question on the first part, the risk management and how are we looking at the whole piece. So just to update you that we don't have any arbitration on anybody except this one arbitration which we are having, you know, since last three four years. So apart from that, there is no arbitration as of now, and we are you know, having a credit policy of ranging from 30 days. To 90 days, depending upon the business situation and the requirement and the opportunity and where are we placed. So the credit terms differ from place to place and from party to party. And we have a policy of blocking the code if the the numbers of days increases from a particular limit. And we have a robust system of getting the money. And obviously we have an ECL model which we have implemented. So anything which goes beyond the credit limit is always provided in books. So whatever is there where which has gone beyond the limit and not come in time as per the credit policy has been provided for. So that ECL model we have already implemented for MHL. So if that answers your question.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir. I'll come back. Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sudarshan Padmanabhan from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. Ma'am, if I take your initial remarks about this COVID testing, where you said that at 4,500 we are barely breaking even, but it helps to absorb the fixed cost. Can you give some color with respect to what are the capacities that we have here? I mean, how is it helping us to cut or utilize it better and reduce the fixed cost over there? And especially if I'm looking at when you're talking about the business coming back to 70% and now in May and running at over 50%. I mean, how much of this proportion is typically COVID and how much of the proportion is COVID?
Sure. What I said in my speech earlier was not that we are barely breaking even. What I said was that it may not add to profit on a unit economic basis, meaning that if we were to just count all the costs that were there, it's not that this is going to be significantly profit accretive. But when we are counting the cost of our fixed manpower, we are counting the cost of the overheads that are involved, direct and indirect, then we are finding that actually it is significantly adding from a group perspective to making sure that in these difficult times when revenues are lower than normal, we are actually able to get to a break-even faster. So on a group basis, it is adding to profitability, but on a test basis, it may not necessarily be adding to incremental profitability. I hope that's clear. So therefore, as we have continued to support all our staff of 4,000 odd people, and pay all the salaries, because at the end of the day, we are a company in healthcare for the long term. So obviously, we don't want to be making any drastic decisions short term of letting go of good talent. So this actually COVID testing is helping us in terms of supporting all those costs. And the fact that we only had a loss in April, when obviously revenue was down because the whole country was in lockdown, but the fact that we have already broken even in May, I think speaks a lot for the point that it is adding to group profitability.
And the capacities and the number of tests that we are doing?
So we are not able to release the details on that right now because we are under confidentiality with the authority on terms of capacity as well as in terms of the data, which is only supposed to come from the authorities, unfortunately. But I can tell you that we have ramped up our capacity significantly in the past 2 weeks. And we are prepared for handling triple the volume that we currently are getting today. And we believe that COVID testing will continue for the next at least 12 months. And we are positioned very well in all the cities that we have got labs in, as well as the places that we are able to collect. So, for example, to give you an example of Maharashtra, while we have a COVID lab in Bombay and Pune, we are collecting samples from all across Maharashtra. And with the project that I mentioned to you, Project UMMEED, which is with the foundation of Cipla and Citibank, this will allow us to scale up our COVID testing even more. Because in this case, the foundations will be paying for the test and not the individuals, which will allow us not only to offer free testing to people who need it, but allow us to ramp up our capacities and build better relationships with authorities as well.
And second is, about 2-3 days ago, ICMR had come out and said that, the 4,500 cap is removed. And it now depends on different states to basically look at the costing and their economics. Should this be positive or how do you see this development?
See, if you see even before ICMR came out with this rule, in practicality, the 4,500 price cap was basically what you can charge a patient. So there were some labs charging 4,500, there were some labs charging lesser than that because it was up to 4,500, so you could decide your price. Metropolis, of course, like all the leading chains, were charging 4,500. But even earlier, before the ICMR notification, the price that the government was paying when they were outsourcing samples was anywhere lower than 4,500 because it becomes like a retail price and a wholesale price. Plus, what we have to remember is that the 4,500 price also includes the collection of samples, which includes new different costs along with the testing. In most cases, when the government is outsourcing or is outsourcing to lab providers, they are collecting the sample and giving us only for the analytical testing. So therefore, the prices have to be different. So my estimate is that on the retail side, I don't think we will see hospitals. So that's number one. Number two, we believe, knowing healthcare for the last 20 years, I can confidently tell you that even though this crisis has happened, we are not going to see healthcare move over 100% to home services, either for diagnostics or for treatment or for doctor visits, right? It's not going to happen. We will see home services increase because people will be preferring to do things at home. But what we also have to remember is that societies and communities may have their own restrictions about letting people from outside come in. So our belief at Metropolis is that this combination of brick and mortar and home services is going to continue. While I believe that home services may scale up, it does not mean that walk-ins are going to decrease, because it's not like the number of patients is finite and the same number of patients are going to get split. So what I expect to see is that we are going to see more and more patients move from unorganized players to organized players. And in the organized players quota, we will see some patients move more to home services. But I don't believe that we are going to see a complete shutdown of brick and mortar. So our plan is really that we should not continue to, that's why we said we are going to do a slight rationalization of our collection center network. And the goal will not be right now to keep expanding centers in the cities where we already believe we have a good network. But the idea will be to now ramp up on the home services front. And as you know, anyway, our collection center network is completely 92% asset light. So frankly, it's not like we are carrying some very large fixed costs on our P&L. That if tomorrow, for whatever reason, the walk-ins are not as much as we expect it to be, it's not going to, you know, make us carry a big fixed cost on our P&L. But we do believe that both will survive and both will do well.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sushmit Soria from Motilal Oswal Asset Management. Please go.
Hi. Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity, and hope everyone is safe at Metropolis. I wanted to understand this write-off that you've taken off something called the old unreconciled balance. Hello?
Yeah, so we have taken some 1.5 crore of write-off for an old unreconciled balance. I think it was taken in quarter two, if I'm not wrong. Hmm. Are you talking about that? So basically what happened is that we have, initiated a reconciliation drive with all the channel partners. To make sure that whatever amount receivable is coming in our books is matching with these channel partners, which they are also having in their books. So we have done a one-time exercise and done the reconciliation with all the channel partners. And after the reconciliation, we found that there were some differences which were there unreconciled, and we are not able to reconcile with the partners. And these are very old balances, because this bill may be belonging to some 2012 or 2013. So, as because these are very old balances and we are not able to reconcile, we have taken a one-time provision of this amount in quarter two for this amount. Hope that clarifies.
I'm assuming that now the systems are such that you may not have anything like this in the future.
Yeah, so we are doing a quarterly reconciliation now. So every quarter we are reconciling. So that, I think, is one-time thing which has happened. And we are now doing a quarterly reconciliation with all the channel partners.
So is there, I'm sorry to ask this, but is there an automated SAP kind of system that helps you do this, or because of the nature of the cash collection?
Sorry, I just lost you in between. Can you repeat?
So we had an SAP system which we are currently using, but unfortunately it was not as automated as we would have liked it to be. And we are actually moving, because it's an older version, we are moving to Oracle NetSuite. We are actually in the process of implementation. We are expecting implementation to be completed, like we said, mid of Q2. And we believe then a lot of these things will become automated and will actually release a lot of productivity and efficiency in the system as we move from more manual methods to automated methods. So right now, like Rakesh said, we are doing our quarterly reconciliation, and we hope that this becomes much more efficient in an automated fashion in the next few months.
Right. And the next question are you already seeing a flush of proposals at your desk for M&A?
We are. We have seen, in the last 2 months, I would say lots of proposals come through. Some of them are companies which, have been traditionally funded by PE. Some of them are companies which are startups who have been working in the healthcare space for the last few years and trying to build traction. And some are, individual labs which feel that they will not be able to operate independently in the new environment. So we are seeing a lot of proposals come through. And our inorganic strategy and thought is very clear that, while we believe that we have the ability to execute M&A very well, probably, better than most in the industry, because we have done about 20, 22 M&A in the past many years and integrated them very well, would like to be prudent as to where we spend our money. So we continue to evaluate each one of them. And of course, if anything comes up which is interesting and at the right time, we would be happy to share.
And just the last question on this global hospital write-off that you've taken. You've taken the whole 100% write-off.
Rakesh?
Yeah. So there are two parts to it. One is up to September outstanding and after September outstanding. So up to September outstanding, as we told that there is some litigation going on. And because of that, now we expect delay in litigation to come up with the results. So we have just prudently taken this provision, whereas our internal assessment and the assessment taken by the third party is that we have a good chance of winning the case. So basically, this is just a prudency because the delay is happening and we don't know now. It may take another 1 year for the litigation to get over. Therefore, we're taking this provision, and the actually disputed amount is up to September. From October onward, we have started getting the money from them, and we have got almost 50% of the amount which we have billed after October to them, and they are paying on a regular basis. So on that basis, we have not provided for the amount which is outstanding after September. But yes, almost 90-95% of the amount which are outstanding from the hospital has been provided for.
And Metropolis continues to work with Global.
So yes, we are right now in the litigation up to September. So that is going on separately, and we are dealing with that separately, and we are very hopeful that we get settled soon. And as we are getting the money from October onwards, so we don't see any reason to stop it. But obviously, we are looking at on a daily basis that whether things are being working fine or not, and we are being cautious about it. So yeah, we are, as of now, we are still operating with that.
Okay. Thank you. Best of luck. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Praveen Ranjan Sahai from Edelweiss. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for taking my question. And thank you for detailed presentation. That's quite helpful. So the first question related to the B2B and B2C, as you are mentioning that the B2C is increasing continuously. So can you elaborate on the B2C definition? It's just on a walk-in patient or the doctor-recommended patients you are including in the B2C, and the B2B is just a hospital business.
Do you
want to
take it?
Yeah, so B2C means where patients are walking into our centers, third party centers, and there is a direct engagement with the patient. So all the patients coming to our lab, whether we are going to their houses to collect samples, and so these are all part of our B2C. Whereas on B2B side, the labs, the hospitals who are outsourcing, where the patient is directly in touch with the B2B lab or hospital, those are all B2B.
Okay, so the B2B is more to do with the hospitals only.
Hospital and labs also.
And labs, okay. And thank you for that. And secondly, on the COVID testing. So as you had already said, that right now you are doing increased in the previous numbers for the test. And also you had mentioned in the presentation that 1.25 crore of a capex you had incurred related to that. So I believe that's related to the five different geographies currently you are doing, and there you had incurred this 1.25 odd crore capex. And with the increase in the coming, number of tests in the coming days, that will also require a further capex related to that, or is that enough?
See, as of now, as we said, that we have five labs, and in order to enhance capacity, because there is going to be more demand from different states, like Gujarat is still not started, so probably Gujarat will also start the day we get approval. So we are ready with our capacity, current capacity, and as Amira mentioned, that we have enough capacity to tackle three times the current volume. So we don't foresee much of capex required in future.
Okay. And just to clarify on the related to this only, as I can see that Thane, Pune, Mumbai and Chennai, there is a lab of Metropolis and operating for a COVID. But you had also mentioned about the Bangalore and Delhi. So is there some other name for that? Other name these labs are operating out there? It's not.
No, they are all under Metropolis brand, and there is no confusion on that. So all across we have Metropolis brand, and all the approvals are under the banner of Metropolis.
But these are not.
We aren't seeing. Yeah. So Delhi is. We are just waiting for approval to come through. We are ready to start. We expect that in the next few days.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for taking my question. All the best.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Bhoomik from Aditya Birla Sun Life Insurance. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. Two questions. One is, if you could give some sense on the payment cycle for related to COVID testing, and sense on how at the peak of the COVID testing, as in whenever you reach it, how big can this become as a part of your overall revenue? And my second question would be, where is the 223 crores of cash invested in?
So I'll just take the first one on COVID, and I'll ask Rakesh to take the one on treasury. I think on COVID, the different channels, like we said, give different price points, and therefore, and different volumes. So what we have tried to do actually is to try and make sure that we are not taking severely discounted business as far as COVID, and therefore we are able to have a decent unit economics on the samples. So therefore, we have been getting business from B2C predominantly, a little bit from government, and some from B2B. The payment cycles for B2C, of course, is cash upfront. For B2B, we have also been doing cash upfront. We have been doing daily cash or rolling advances with most of the B2B players. And then government is the only one where you're giving a little bit of credit. For us, government is a small percentage of the COVID business, so we don't see it as too much of a risk. And some of the governments have already started paying. As far as how big this can get, I mean, at this point of time, as far as RT-PCR goes, I expect that we'll continue doing a significant amount of testing for the next few months. Probably it'll go over the next 12 months, but definitely the next 3-4 months will be quite heavy. If they open up antibody testing, then of course, it's a much larger number. And if for RT-PCR, they open it up for asymptomatic, which we are also hearing they might, then of course, it opens up, for the whole country. So it's very difficult to estimate today because it's very driven by regulatory approvals on what is allowed and not allowed. Difficult to estimate. It's very binary. So if it can become big, I think, we can be doing 10,000, 15,000 tests per day. But, whether we'll get there or not depends on the regulatory environment.
Yeah, so coming to the second question where you said that what are we exactly doing about on the cash reserve which we have. So out of 223 crore, we have some 13 crore of investment in mutual fund. Fortunately, that investment has not devaluated at all, because that was more from a debt investment rather than equity investment. So that investment is intact. The rest of 200 crore, we have around 20% of that is with a
we keep it for us so that we can have day-to-day expenditure and everything can be taken care of, vendor payments. Out of the rest, we have 50% which has been invested in the long-term FD, and rest has been invested in the short-term FD. So basically, we are cautious now not to invest in a long-term basis because we don't know how the situation will fare up. So we are prudent and we are keeping cash in the short-term investment so that we can take it whenever there is a requirement. So that's how it is. If any further question?
Sure, that's helpful. Just one clarification. So this 13 crores which is lying in the debt mutual funds, that's, I'm assuming it is all AAA rated and liquid?
Yes. So we have not devalued anything in this. In fact, sure. There's an increase.
All right. And if one last question, if I may squeeze in. So this is for Ameera. So if you can just a little long-termish, and you did allude to this in the opening remarks also in terms of, how the industry structure could move more towards consolidation and more towards the organized players. But if you could just, talk a little bit more about, mainly from the regulatory side, now that the government has clearly bifurcated the accredited and, the other labs. How does that help, in the long term in the overall scheme of things? Does it really speed up the process? How do you look at it?
Let me just give you some little perspective on the industry. See, currently there's estimated to be about 100,000 labs in the country. There are about 150 labs which have been approved for COVID, right? Out of 100,000. Now these 150 labs are all pathologists run. A reasonably good quality, well-known labs in their city. And out of the 100,000 labs, just to give you an estimate, there are 10,000 which are run by pathologists and 90,000 run by technicians, right? So the bigger issue are the unorganized technician labs, which do very, very small business, but are in every nook and corner. So what our estimation is that honestly, with COVID testing becoming such a big thing and talk about pathology testing happening for months on end, we think that in the mind of the consumer who never really thought about the quality of pathology before in a significant way, now they're going to be thinking about the brands that they have heard for the last 3 months, and they're going to be thinking about, look, who's capable of doing this kind of advanced testing and who's not. And out of these 150 labs which have been approved by ICMR for testing, just factually for you to know, 50% have not done a single test so far. So actually, it is only 75 private labs which have actually done whatever 30% of the entire testing so far done in the country. And out of the 75, the top 5 chains have done majority. So what we have seen is actually in a crisis-like situation, it has been the leaders in the country which have actually carried most of the weight. And consumers and doctors and governments and hospitals have seen our faces on a daily basis, while they have not seen the small unorganized players at all. Our sense is that this will lead to consolidation. Like we said, there are a lot of M&A proposals already coming through. But even on the organic side, we think customers who are used to moving to the local lab next door will now start moving to a more reputed brand. And frankly, the small labs are now having a hard time functioning because their labor is not, they don't have enough labor to continue working. And tomorrow, when customers are going to demand that we are now wanting safety and hygiene. For example, today, if you come, get a Metropolis person to come home, whether you're doing a COVID test or not, there is somebody coming with a full PPE kit. There's somebody trained to show you how every glove and needle is disinfected. Now, your expectation is going to be the same when you go to a lab, a small lab next to your house. Now, when that small lab has to start bearing the cost that Metropolis does, they will not be able to afford it at the prices that they charge. And so either they will have to increase their prices, and the difference between the reputed player prices and unorganized prices will decrease. And that will make then patients actually move towards the brands more. So I think this is a journey that we will go through over the next many months.
Thank you so much for the detailed response, and thanks for the detailed presentation as well, and all the best.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Anuj Sehgal from Manas Asian Equities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, good evening. I just wanted to check, so your network has increased by 6.4 times in the last 5 years. So what percentage of your revenue do you get from your own centers, from third-party centers and from ARC? And then secondly, you know, while longer term the industry will consolidate, as you just mentioned, is there a risk that in the near term, a lot of your third-party centers could also actually shut down, and therefore that could actually affect business in the near term, even after, you know, things come back to normalcy in the next few months?
So as far as, you know, we haven't got the specific details on third party versus our own, etc. But I can tell you that our own centers are still contributing a large amount of the B2C revenue. The network that we have created in the last, 3 years has an average aging of only about 2 years, right? So 1.5 to 2 years. So that's why we keep saying it's still a very young network. And usually the maturity is about 5 years. For a collection center to get to top revenue. So therefore, a smaller percentage of our revenues come from the third party network at this point of time, but we are seeing that continuously increase every quarter, and that will continue to increase. That's one point. As far as your second question on, you know, will the third party partners survive? Frankly, I'm not sure why they would not be able to, because they don't require any huge working capital to this. It's not like they're buying goods from us in advance and holding inventories. Usually the way it works for a franchise partner is that a patient walks into their center, at least for the retail franchise partners, a patient walks into their center, pays cash, and usually we collect either daily cash or weekly cash from our partners. And usually the consumables that they are using to bleed the patient is provided by Metropolis. So I think the only change that might happen now is that if the PPE is required for patients, there will be an additional cost as far as the PPE. And we will be working out with our partners as to how do we make sure that that cost is not burden them or burden us separately.
And just a follow-up. So, you know, you mentioned that you will be rationalizing your third-party network and reducing it by 15%. So in the last couple of months, have you seen any churn in the network where some centers have not opened up, even though they were allowed to open up in different geographies?
Isn't that you want to take that?
Yeah, there were a few centers, especially during COVID, where we ourselves had said that we do not open the centers till we come back to you. So that time the risk was very high, and people were also a little scared on what's going to happen. But slowly, gradually, we started, you know, asking third-party centers to open. And as Amira mentioned, that we are already planning about 10 to 15% of our centers who are non-performers in the ARC segment. It automatically would take care of our cost versus, you know, the risk of churn, because that itself would be our initiative to take it up so that there is no risk.
So the 15% rationalization is only on the ARC and not on the third party centers.
Yeah, majorly good on ARC.
And may I ask, what is the difference between ARC and third-party centers?
So ARCs generally are in non-lab towns where this particular segment is open to cater to B2B, you know, collection of samples on behalf of Metropolis from hospital and small time labs. They are part of our B2B strategy.
Okay, so ARC business is categorized under the B2B part of the business.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Amol Gadju from JM Financial. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks, Amira, for taking my question. My question is to Amira. Amira, you spoke about the current disruption being some kind of a catalyst in terms of driving the unorganized to organized shift. In terms of some granular details or nuts and bolts, can you help us understand how is this playing out on the ground? One way, obviously, is, you know, patients being more comfortable, that's on the revenue side. But are you seeing similar behavior on the cost side with, you know, probably vendors or, you know, landlords trying to make, trying to give you better terms given the distress on the landscape?
So as Vijinder mentioned, in March itself, we approached sort of all the landlords of our centers that we own, and obviously they value the fact that a company like Metropolis is tenant with them. So most of them were very happy to offer us sort of flexible terms for the period of the lockdown. which we have come to an understanding with them on. But I think, Anmol, it's still a little bit early to know whether on the cost side we are going to get benefits from a perspective of unorganized and organized. I mean, we always got benefits from a perspective of material costs, you know, because obviously just the pure economies of scale gave us much better pricing power with vendors. That was always the case. But I sense that the changes will come more on the one on the talent perspective, because you know, while in the last 3 months we have been open every single day, and not a single employee of Metropolis has lost their job or had any salary cut. The reality is that 90% of small labs have been shut. And obviously, I think it will be very difficult for them to continue to support salary payments when they are completely getting no revenues at all. So my sense is that talent itself will also start migrating towards more secure and safe pastures, like companies like ours. But I don't, at least personally, I have not seen any witness of that on the ground yet. This is just a hunch. I think it's still early for that. But definitely changing on the demand side for sure. Vinda, do you want to add anything? Anything you've seen differently? Hello?
Hello, that's fine, Amira. That's fine. Yeah. So a follow-up on that, right now, since the case you know, for organic growth relative to given the distress on the landscape has improved so much, does M&A as an option become less appealing? Because anyway, you guys are now a, you know, far clearer runway for growth going forward.
See, I think the market is still very, very fragmented, right? Like we've always said, the top few players, the top three, four players in the country are only 10 to 15% of the entire market share and of the entire industry. So yes, while there is going to be an opportunity to continue to grow organically, again, you know, I don't think things are going to drastically change overnight because at the end of the day, you're in healthcare, you're with relationships, you're with services. So while I do think organically will things will change, I don't think we should completely disregard M&A at the same time. I think there will still be good opportunities, chances to consolidate faster along with organic growth. And we as a company would like to continue to evaluate both opportunities, organic and inorganic, at the same level.
Thank you. That's helpful. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Chandramouli from Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening, and thank you for taking my question. The first question is related to your prepared remarks. You mentioned that about 50% of the network was working as in late May, and this compares to 25% of the network as in late March. So is this collection centers?
This is collection centers as well as labs.
Right. And just a clarification on that, could you just give us the numbers on patient service centers specifically?
We have 260 patient collection centers overall, which are owned and operated by us. Plus, how many do we have which are third party, ATSU?
1800. ATSU. No, sorry. I was trying to understand what percentage of the patient service center network is open now versus in late March.
Oh, I see. Isn't that you have an answer to that?
Yeah, now it is almost about 70% centers which are opened on the B2C side.
Got it. That's helpful. And second question is on the cost side. So if I just move your EBITDA margin of maybe 25-26% out in a steady state basis, so of the remainder 75% of your costs of your sales, which are costs, what proportion would be fixed in your opinion as a percentage of sales?
Okay.
Yeah, so there are a lot of costs which are, you know, not in the bottom line, so we absolutely can't, you know, even that bifurcate in a, you know, absolute way. But if I just take an overall picture and see in that term, so I think the 50% of the cost basically fall into my variable and semi-variable and fixed cost, and the rest 50%, you know, depends upon. And again, if the fixed cost changes, then the volume changes. For example, if the volume goes up, then the fixed cost basically changes. But in a normal time, if you look at, so almost 50% the ratio.
Got it. And just given the pressure on volumes this quarter and maybe the next quarter as well, I'm sure there are initiatives on trying to bring the fixed cost down. So if you could just give us some color on what sort of costs you think you can rationalize over the medium term.
Yeah, so just to give you a perspective, I think as has been told, you know, the rent has been a bit negotiated with all the landlords, and landlords are kind enough to come back and, you know, support us in this endeavor. So that is one fixed cost which has seen a bit of reduction. But obviously, once the lockdown eases out and things become a bit normal, so then that will go away. So that is one cost which we are looking at. Some costs which will naturally go down, which are regarded as fixed costs, but will go down automatically, go down, for example, traveling cost and conveyance cost. These costs are actually fixed costs, but these will reduce drastically because of the situation today we are in. There are some costs like printing stationery. We are more into, you know, sending the reports through mails and through digital mode. So we are seeing you know, a lot of saving in the printing stationery space also. While we are spending a lot of money in the digital platform and, you know, to connect with the customers, doctors and our centers and everybody, but the bottom line, the marketing cost has gone down because there's no point of, you know, spending in that line. So these are some of the costs which basically are, you know, seeing a bit of a downtrend. And obviously, you know, we go forward, we will see how can we, you know, try to maintain it even if our revenue is around.
Got it. Thank you very much, Nagar.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sameer Baisiwala from Morgan Stanley. Please go ahead.
Hi, good evening. Thanks. Amir, the volume set for Lost in last 3 months, is this a pent-up demand or is it a lost volume story?
See, my sense is, I think firstly, the volumes which have been lost have been, you know, of course, mostly March end. I would not say last 3 months. Of course, the economy itself was struggling a little bit before that. So, you know, there's some impact, but not huge. But of course, most of it is end of March, the last 15 days. You know, the general thought in healthcare industry is what has happened is that with the lockdown, all elective surgeries have been postponed. People getting sick have been self-treating at home, but obviously that will also come back to bite people, unfortunately, once the lockdown opens. So I would estimate, my sense is half of it would be suppressed demand and half of it would be volume, which would be completely lost. Because, you know, if I had a cold and a fever and I didn't get a chance to go to a GP and I took a close and I treated myself, the chances that in the last, in which you can't, I've managed to become okay. You know, unless it's COVID, of course. But, you know, things like elective surgery, somebody needs to get a knee replacement done and they have to delay it. They'll have to go at some point. Surgery will require testing. So my estimate is it's half-half.
Okay. And Amir, when you mention about potentially COVID testing being as high as 10 to 15,000 tests per day, these are all antigen PCR tests, or were you including antibody also here?
No, I was only referring to PCR. I mean, if tomorrow antibody test opens up, frankly, it can be much more than that. It can become like a thyroid test, right, for a period of time. Thyroid tests are extremely high volume tests in our industry. So if antibodies opened up, because that's easy to do, it's like a thyroid test. It takes a couple of hours, you know, to do a test and to give a report. And it can be completely automated. And actually, if you see Roche Diagnostics has come out with an antibody test, which has got US FDA approval, and we actually have the largest capacity for immunoassay testing with Roche all across the country. So for us to be able to execute large-scale antibody testing would not be difficult. So that depends on the regulatory framework. That could be close to like 100,000, 200,000 tests a day. But, you know, these are all numbers today without any, without much basis, till obviously the government opens it up.
Okay, no, that's great. And as far as your partnership with Cipla and Citi is concerned, I don't know if it's a right question, what pricing would this be done at?
We'd love to share some needs, but we are under confidentiality.
Okay, no worries. And I mean, the last one on COVID testing. Which is, are large corporations approaching you as the lockdown is lifted, they open manufacturing sites, offices, large banks, IT companies, they want to test the entire, you know, office, entire, you know, workforce?
Absolutely. Lots of companies are approaching us, but at this point of time, from a regulation perspective, we are not allowed to because their people, all their employees are asymptomatic, and ICMR today does not allow us to do our asymptomatic testing. So, like I said, if they change the screening criteria and they allow asymptomatic testing, then frankly, I think all of India who can afford a test would want to get one done. So, you know, that and antibody testing are two things which are with the government.
That's great. I mean, just persist on this point one more time, and that is, what's the thought process with the regulator and the government, ICMR? I mean, it's going to only help their cause in containing the virus if they do allow both these things. So is it a matter of time, or they think that India is not prepared for it? What's driving this?
I mean, I can't pretend to know their mindset, but my guess and my personal opinion would be that at this point of time, they think that there is a shortage of capacity of testing, and therefore they want to give first priority to people who are symptomatic and need the testing. And probably, I think it's a matter of time that they will open it up for you know, different asymptomatic people or potentially antibody. I mean, traditionally, if you see, antibody testing is actually not meant for individual patients. It's actually meant for surveillance to know the health data of a population. Now, whether the government will choose to do this on their own or they will engage private players with them to do it, I would suspect that they would engage private players. You know, time will tell.
Okay, great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, due to time constraint, we take that as the last question. I would now like to hand the conference over to Ms. Ameera Shah for her closing comments. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, and thank you all for joining us. We know we recognize the speech is a little long today. We just wanted to give you a lot of visibility and color on exactly what we are thinking, where we are going. It's uncertain times, but we want to create as much certainty as we can in these uncertain times for our investors and stakeholders. And like I had mentioned earlier, we remain very strong and confident on our fundamentals. I think our operating performance stands tall and industry leading. And we genuinely hope that as things open up, as lockdown opens up, we will continue to get only stronger in our performance. And we look forward to sharing with you as soon as possible in the next few months. Thank you all.
Thank you. On behalf of Metropolis Healthcare Limited, we conclude today's conference. Thank you all for joining. You may now disconnect your lines.